Okay, hello, this is Dan, also known as our Biker Scout, and I'm happy to be on another live stream this week and give you guys another live stream. And we have three people here, and we'll be joined by one more in just a little bit. But our featured guest is Adam Paulus from GalacticHunter.com and also 16bit.com and so on. He'll introduce himself, but we also Steve, also known as SithLord229, who is my co-host here. If you don't know, he's part of the channel now. So,
hello.
So we'll just introduce you. Everybody can introduce themselves. Adam, do you want to talk about where everybody can find you and just a little bit about what you are doing currently?
Well, our host told me a good chunk of it. I've been writing about this stuff for too long. You can find me at GalacticHunter.com. You can find me at 16bit.com. And I also do stuff for EntertainmentEarth.com and other people I consult with elsewhere. But if you go to 16bit.com, you can pretty much find a link to everything I do.
Great. It's great to have you on, Adam.
Well, it's great to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Cool.
And then, Kowal?
Kowal, hi.
Sorry.
My channel is MKM Films. This is my second time I've done a Google, what's it called, a live hangout. So, yep, I'm glad to be on this show. So, okay.
And you guys should know Steve, also known as SithLord229. But if you want to want to get the show going with the first topic or question there.
Absolutely. Like I said, we've got a few topics to discuss, but one of the things that I sort of jotted down was, since we've got sort of a multi-generational sort of podcast or stream going on, I wanted to talk about the dark times, which, correct me if I'm wrong, was 1987 to 1991 for Star Wars merchandise?
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Sounds about right.
Yeah.
I'm probably the oldest here, so, yeah.
Yeah,
I mean, because I remember getting Star Wars figures back in 78, and then, you know, all that sort of stuff, so.
Yeah, I wasn't here
back
yet.
Back to Adam, yeah.
So Adam, did you, how many figures did you have as a kid, and what were you doing during the dark times as far as collecting, the dark years?
For me personally, there really weren't any dark years, because I've likened myself to the cockroach of the hobby, which is, when you guys are all dead, I will be rooting through your garbage and taking your stuff. And that's sort of what I did in 1987, because I went to my first collectible toy show when I was about 6. And I had maybe 20, 30 figures when Return of the Jedi ran its course. And then it was all garage sales, flea markets, antique shows from there. So there was always some way to get something new between Toy Shop Magazine, which was this big tabloid-sized newsprint thing in the U.S. You'd thumb through hundreds of classified ad pages looking for one guy who says, I collect Star Wars stuff, send me a self-addressed stamped envelope, and I'll give you a list of what I have. And then mail it off to him, you see what you get. And you have to network with a lot of people. But during that era, it was great, because everyone's like, well, Star Wars was dead, and it was. There was very little new going on. But thankfully, during that time, everybody wanted to never think about Star Wars again. And because of that, I could say, like, okay, well, all your stuff's worthless. I'll take it. And I did. And it was great. You know, I didn't hoard it, but, you know, like a dollar figure, $2 figure. I paid $2 for my carded size from figure. It was a great time to be alive.
Cool. Okay, well, what did you collect at that time? They were collecting some things at the time.
Yeah, I mean, because I'm probably the oldest here, so, I mean, I got the figures back in 78, and by the time I was 14, 84, I lost the interest in Star Wars. That's when the first sort of home computers came out, so my interest went to the home computers, and then after that, you know, you're studying as well, you're doing your O-levels, A-levels later, so, you know, you had to focus on that, and so there was, I mean, the thing was, I always kept my Star Wars stuff under my bed, though. I never let my mum throw it away. And then 91, 92, the Thrawn trilogy, the first book came out, Heir to the Empire, and then my mate said, because he was into comics, he says, you know, there's a Dark Empire comic, you should start collecting that. And I went into another comic shop, and there was Star Wars figures, like a Bib Fortuna carded for £3, so I picked that up, and, you know, started collecting after that.
But you were going after the carded. Were you going after carded items at that time, or ever, Adam? Are you a carded?
I have a few carded items. Like, I have a signed Mark Hamill, Luke Skywalker figure, and a couple others, but typically speaking, I don't collect packaging for space reasons, and it just never really interested me. If you can't touch it, you can't learn from it. You can look at it, and that's nice, but I'm also in the toy consulting business, so for me, it's really important to get my hands on things and say, this is what worked, this is what didn't, and here's what I'm going to do for my next client when I'm saying, like, okay, well, this is what you want to do, and here's an example of it. It has a certain aesthetic value to it, but don't need it.
Fair enough. Silence.
I guess I'm a visual person. I'm quite artistic as well, so I quite like the packaging, and I think maybe there's a kind of nostalgia associated with the packaging. I'm going to show you a vintage figure carded, so you see. I don't know if you can see it that well, but you've got. This is quite a rare one, so you know.
That looks
very
like Jenna May Dean on a path.
Yep. So this is a very rare thing, but I mean, I like the visual appeal. I think that's why the vintage collection was such a success as well. Yeah. So.
It really wasn't. It kind of didn't do as well as people wanted.
How so? You mean the last line being internet exclusive was like a bad
Not even internet exclusive. The whole year had exceptionally weak distribution. Typically when a line does well, it doesn't end up at a closeout chain like Five Below. That's sort of the opposite of success. The first waves didn't do what they should have. The case packouts didn't do what they should have. And as a result, there's probably a good number of figures in the system that haven't gotten out yet. We'll find out in the next year or so for sure. But it just didn't... I don't think you can meet a single collector who would say that line was successful. It certainly was popular. People liked it. People claimed they liked it. And the lack of availability probably drove it through the ground. And that's why we saw such a big change in 2013. The 2012 line didn't do what it was supposed to. I don't think the 2013 line is going to do what it's supposed to. We'll see. I mean, there are certain... Everyone has different definitions of success depending on if you're the manufacturer, the licensor, the retailer, the collector. I would say, as a group, the product was something that appealed to us, by and large. The vintage selection was great. Starkiller, A New Royal Guard, Lumet, finally, I love Ewoks. But I see no evidence that the retailers really got what they were supposed to out of it, especially the big box retailers in the U.S., the product didn't turn over very quickly. They clearly didn't understand it. Target's had issues managing inventory and continues to with the Black Series by putting all those under the same SKU in their system internally. It's just not a good direction for them to go in, and I think we're going to see the same problem with Black Series this year, Series 2 and 3. Don't get your hopes up for seeing it everywhere.
It seems like that's a pattern, though, going back all the way to 95, really. I mean, always the first waves are the ones
strongly
that are
disagree
always...
with you there.
Okay.
But basically, in 95, July of 95 is when the first Power of the Force figures hit, August a little bit better. There wasn't a second wave until December, so it was 3-4 months, and the first figures didn't show up till the first one I saw was December 26 of that year. They didn't really start hitting more until January, February. Then the next wave came out in March. It got a little bit better after that, but after that, with collectors, it's always, I can't find everything, or this is a peg warmer, and there's really no in-between, because back then, everyone was like, I can't find anything new, I can't find anything new. Like, a month and a half after Dagobah, Luke, and Hoth Han hit, you never wanted to see them again. And they were everywhere for another year. And that's sort of what happened last year. We had Wave 1 of the Vintage Guys, where we had basically 12 figures assuming that role, and when a store gets between, usually more than 24 figures, doesn't matter what figures they are, they're not going to reorder. They're going to say, I've got enough. And that piles it up. So you had a situation where people were saying, like, they did want to buy new stuff, but at the same time, there was too much stuff there that nobody wanted. And some of it was fan-demanded stuff, and that's increasingly a problem as the line continues, because back in 95, people could all get on the same page. They would say, I want Wedge, I want Slave Leia, and I want Grand Moff Tarkin. And we all agreed. And today, you ask three collectors what you want. I mean, if you guys all just named off your top figure off the top of your head right now, I don't know if they would be the same guy, or you'd even agree.
No, that's true. I guess what I'm thinking of is, like, the later waves were somewhat hard to find. Like, even like with Parla Force, like the Expanded Universe wave is hard to find. The last waves of Legacy or Saga Blue or any of those last waves. I guess that was what my mindset was thinking.
But yeah,
I remember that time where Dagobah Luke and Hoth Han, where there was tons of them. So was that, at that point, didn't Hasbro like take them off the shelves even at that point? Like, they took some away?
Back in the 90s, transparency is difficult to get, especially in that era, but... I actually found this at Toys R Us. They actually shipped empty cartons to Toys R Us with the product to be returned on the side. So I don't know if any of you guys have ever ordered a sealed case of figures, but it says assortment, whatever, there's a 9-digit number. These were specific to a certain figure. So, for example, Beast Wars Transmetals Scavenger, it's this metal ant figure. They would ship empty cases with that name on the side to Toys R Us with the instructions that the retailer send it back for whatever they're going to do with it. I never found out what the end game was. There's been rumors it was Goodwill. Target dumps a lot of their stuff to Goodwill stores. Sometimes it gets destroyed. I think that's probably not going to happen. I'm assuming it gets donated somewhere in the world, maybe not in the U.S. But the evidence of that happening since Legacy is difficult to find. There's been a couple of people saying that they think that's what happened, and a couple of people mentioned said they talked to a rep, but it's just not something you see as much. Back in the 90s, I remember you would see people in Hasbro t-shirts at Toys R Us every now and again, but I have not seen that at all lately, and I'm certainly not going to the stores less than I was back then. So, but yeah, it's like what Legacy is when things started getting a little bit worse, but I would say if you really look at it, other than that last wave of Power of the Force, by and large, everything made it out. I think I've seen everything pre-Legacy in store except for the Dark Trooper in 98. I mean, granted, some of the stuff I found was like New Year's morning. I hadn't slept in a day, but I did find it, and it did get out there, and sometimes it made it out to weird clearance places, GameStop, alternative channels. It was produced. It does exist. It just didn't make it out in the big... Back then it was top five. Now it's top three stores in the U.S. But if you look at eBay, I mean, if anything, time shows you that it made it out there and no one cares. If you want it today, you can have it, which is nice.
So you would you say Star Wars distribution was, I mean, since you collect multiple lines, I guess follow-up to that question would be just, you think that distribution problem right now is isolated to Star Wars or
no.
All over the board on Hasbro?
Hasbro has changed significantly how it views its toy lines and how often things come out. We complain in Star Wars, but take, for example, Transformers. There's a line called Transformers Generations. It's basically the equivalent of vintage for Transformers, I think is a good way to put it, or close to it. They're characters from the original comics, TV shows, toy line. There was a wave that came out around Christmas. The next new wave came out around July. There are gaps. There are problems. And they hit a little bit better when they hit compared to Star Wars, but there are still major issues. We see with Iron Man, they put out Wave 1 for Iron Man 3 in January. Wave 2 doesn't come out until July. There's huge gaps. And back in the late 2000s, they would have something like Titanium series where there'd be a new wave every 30 to 45 days. You could set your watch to it almost. Same thing with Legacy. The intent was that they would be out regularly. And now Hasbro seems okay with letting people wait 4, 5, 6 months, which I think is terrible because even if you collect multiple lines, especially in the early 2000s, you would have a reason to go to the store all the time because there's going to be a new Star Wars item, there's going to be a new Transformers item, there's going to be a new G.I. Joe item. You wouldn't get bored. Right now, if you collect toys and that's your reason for getting out of the house, there's no reason to get out of bed most weeks. Everything's online or it's just months and months and months apart. You know there's going to be new stuff during the August reset. You know there's going to be new stuff in the spring reset, which is anywhere between January, March, whatever they feel like these days. But in between, it's a big old question mark. They could just decide not to do it. And we saw that with year one of Vintage. They would have 2-3 waves set at about the same time, which isn't good because it makes people spend a lot of money at once, which means they realize how much they're spending, which stops people from buying things. And at the same time, you have nothing to do for months, and collectors who get bored find other things to do. I like video games. I like records. I like all kinds of stuff. And if I have no reason to pay attention to the toy aisle for months at a time, I could leave the hobby, conceivably. Granted, I won't, but other people could. And that's not good for any of us. I mean, you know, there's something to be said about being engaged in whatever it is you're involved in. Toys got so slow this summer, I bought Hot Wheels.
Oh, boy.
I didn't have any Hot Wheels. Now I got like 100.
Well, would you say in the UK it's the same problem, the same waves where the distribution problems were there for you guys, right? Mm. The Phantom Menace wave is everywhere, and the first wave was everywhere from Vintage. But everything else was hit or miss for as far as the waves, whether you find them, or would you say that's not true?
Vintage was very hit and miss in terms of what came out and what didn't. Over here, the first wave and the second wave hit fine, and then after that, it was very spotty in the sense that wave three in the US came out. I think it was fairly quickly after wave two, if I'm not mistaken. I think
Wave 1 was July, August. Wave 2 was September, October. Wave 3 was late November, early December.
Yeah. For us, I don't think Wave 3 hit us until the new year, well after the new year. And then Wave 4 was probably out at the same time that Wave 6 or 7 was out for you guys. But we eventually caught up, and it was really weird. It was almost as though they were trying to play a catch up, and it was very, very patchy. But we did get that problem where two or three waves hit at once, and like Adam said, we were realizing how much money we were spending. I definitely did, and I think I put myself into a depression induced coma for a while, and I realized how much I'd spent on the stuff. It's something that as long as I've been collecting, it's always been an issue. Getting stuff out there at the same time as the US, it's always been like that, as far as I'm aware. But I've only been collecting since sort of the Power of the Force days, so, and back then I wasn't really sort of clued up on all the insider stuff, so it could have been different. But hi, Logan, as well.
Hi, Steve. Glad to see you again.
Joker Fed has joined us. If you don't know Joker Fed, yes.
Hi, everybody. Hello. I apologize for my tardiness.
I don't know how the comments are coming along. We have a number of viewers, but I don't know if there's any comments or questions.
Yeah.
If you are watching, you can ask comments or questions, and we'll get to them as soon as we can here on the show. So go back to those days. How did you, Adam, get involved, I guess, like, online? When did you first, like, get on the internet? How did you decide to start writing about Star Wars? And did you write about more than that right away? Or did you go through, like, sort of your 90s history on your writing?
Sure. In 1991, we got Prodigy. It's an online service that no one remembers. I was on that, and I started reading about other stuff on there, specifically Star Trek The Next Generation and Star Wars. Not much was going on with Star Wars, and Galoob put out the Star Trek Next Generation micro machines I saw, and I'm like, oh, this is great. And that's when I started monitoring stuff closely. I started writing letters to Galoob, angry letters, attention to the CEO, and they wrote back. Because I said they put out a gift set where you had to rebuy all the Star Wars and Star Trek micro machines to get the Enterprise A and the Super Star Destroyer. Because they had three packs, and then they had a 10-pack and a 19-pack. And I was very upset by this, because at $2 a week allowance, I didn't want to buy it again. So I said, hey, what gives? This is terrible. I'm trying to buy your stuff. I'm not made of money. I want to buy everything you make, but this is preposterous. So the CEO writes back and says, oh, we're very sorry. Here's the Enterprise. Here's the Super Star Destroyer. Here's our catalog. Here's everything we're making in the next year. Thanks for writing. Let us know if you want to know anything else. And I wrote them. They probably had it in development, but I actually wrote them. Like, there was this line in the 80s called the Micro Collection. They had these little vehicles and these little figures, and you got to make something like that. And 2 years later, Action Fleet came out. I'm sure they're already doing it. I take no responsibility for it. And I did the same thing with Playmates. I would write them for Next Generation figures, and they would send back a list with a dot matrix printer printout of everything that was going on. And I'm like, you can actually get information from people. And I knew some people locally who were trying to become a Lucasfilm licensor, because Lucasfilm Licensing had a magazine they would send people. That's how good they were keeping secrets. They sent out a full-color print magazine to people who were making stuff. And you could get all kinds of information a year or two early from this, like figures, licensees, all kinds of stuff that no one was writing about yet. So by August of 95, the big thing was Fruit Loops. Some of you know exactly what I'm about to say. Fruit Loops cereal had a mail-in offer for a Han Solo Stormtrooper. There was a rumor back in August and July, no one knew it was true. It sounded like a load of crap. Why wouldn't you think it was a load of crap? It sounds ridiculous. But I started writing a newsletter basically as soon as I found out that it was real, because I'm like, well, people want to know about this. Someone has to read about it somewhere. I'm going to do this email newsletter I'm going to send out to people and let them know what I find out, just so they know, yes, it's true, go look for it, you can find it. The same day my dad lost his job, and I was pretty young, and I'm like, oh, crap, I got to find a way to make money for this stuff. So that's one of the other reasons I did the newsletter, was hopefully someday to get an advertiser. And my first advertiser is now my boss, which works out very nicely. But long story short, I had thousands of readers, made lots of contacts, and Lucasfilm got a lot better about keeping their mouth shut, so I don't have as many scripts I can talk about. But I signed a lot of NDAs now, too, so I can't talk about certain things anymore, too. So it just worked out really well. When the internet took off, everyone was interested in new and exciting things and pursuing their hobby. It wasn't all just porn on the internet. Some people were nerds and they wanted to know about Star Wars, and that was me. So that's the area I went down, and it did really well for me. I was writing magazine articles and freelancing for people before I finished high school, which was great because I wanted a Nintendo 64 and a Sega Saturn, and my hobby helped pay for it. And I didn't have to scalp figures either, like some of the other jerks. I got to just get paid for writing about what I love, getting my figures, and it was a great experience when the internet took off because I had a head start for the next generation of jobs and stuff.
Wow.
Awesome.
That's awesome. Great. So you actually got, did your Q&A start off a few years after? Like you have a Monday Q&A, right?
It used to be 3 times a week at Rebel Scum. That's how many questions I got. And each installment was 10 or 20 questions. So I was writing 30 to 60 answers a week. Just not that many people ask questions anymore. It's an easy thing to do if people are interested in reading what you have to say. My readership has remained steady since, I say, 98, 99. But the questions have reduced since people understand how Google and eBay work. Because a lot of times people say, well, what's this worth? It's like, you can see what it sells for on eBay. Well, I want you to tell me. I'm like, I'm going to tell you to go look at eBay. Mm-hmm. And Q&A is a great, great format. I stole it from Next Generation, which is a video game magazine. They did it. That was my favorite thing they did. And it was the one thing I made sure I read every week because they told me something I wanted to know. And I'm like, I should do that for Star Wars. There couldn't possibly be that much interest, though. And I'm glad to say there was. It's really a rewarding thing. I think people like seeing their stuff in print. People like finding out things. And while I can't answer everything in the column, I read every question, and I take them, a lot of them, to the various manufacturers when I meet with them in whatever environment I'm meeting with them, and hope to just put a bug in their ear or get an answer. The funny thing is, some people just don't know the answer. I mean, there are some questions that are very esoteric, even for our unique group of people. And coming to other people and just saying, like, well, how come Vader's cape was like this and not that? And sometimes they're just going to look at you like, I don't care. I care. And they probably do care. But, you know, it's just one of those things like, I don't know. I made that a year ago. Leave me alone, kid. And I'm like, okay.
Nice. Steve?
Uh-huh. Yeah, we're making our way through the topics. This is one that I was looking forward to asking, Adam, and that is, are there any questions that you've been asked on your Q&A or through the comments on your various outlets that have stuck in your mind or been funny or memorable?
The funniest memorable one is that there was some mistaken identity at Galactic Hunter, because right now it's basically two guys, me and Mike. Mike founded it. We had another guy named Adam on there too, and that got a little confusing because when you have two guys named Adam, people don't necessarily know which one was which, and they were asking various questions about he's a great guy, really cool. He's also happens to be gay. And they were asking me how the gay night life was in Indianapolis during the Star Wars celebration and where they should go, and I'm just like, I don't know. I don't know how the straight night life is in Indianapolis. In case you haven't met me, I haven't exactly dated that many people. And that was just really funny. And it's just an awkward thing because you don't want to make the guy feel bad. It's just like, I don't know. I'm so sorry. Let me see if I can direct you to someone who can help you. I felt embarrassed because I didn't know how to. I'm usually good at answering questions people send to me. Even if it has nothing to do with Star Wars, I'm like, I can help you. And now it's just like, I have no idea. I'm so sorry. I apologize. I'll get you the next one, I promise. But most of them have to do with, especially, oh man, in the late 90s, it was all about, when will this Darth Maul figure be worth enough to sell? And I would just be like, well, you know, more than likely it's not going to be worth anything. The packaging is really durable. The card back's much higher quality. It's probably not going to crease. The figure might not yellow or anything like that, so I wouldn't count on it. And they got so mad. It was hilarious. I loved that. I mean, it just, every time, you know, somebody who's speculating on this stuff gets angry and cries, it just gives me a little spring in my step. It makes my day better. I just want to see people choke on this stuff. That's all. I mean, buy it because you love it. You're going to, you know, if you're not in love with this as a hobby, if everything you look at, it, you don't get something from it. Even the figure you hate, you should get something from it. Mm. And I have a big problem when people continue to buy stuff and don't. There was this great Onion headline where it was something along the effect of, man's train hobby becomes train habit. And I'd say that's true of about 90% of my readers and me. So we have to be careful about that, because once you lose perspective of why you're here and why you're doing it, it's reflected in the column, it's reflected in the questions. People are, and since the very beginning, they've been, why is Hasbro making me buy this? Well, they're not. You chose to buy it. Yeah. You went to the store, you plunked down your money, and you left the store with it. You could have left it there. I mean, there's all kinds of things I don't buy. It is interesting to see where we have evolved as a group to feel compelled to pick up some of this stuff, even the stuff we hate, and that is unfortunate. But with the last year and the diversions in the hobby, you see each string of figures go in a different direction. People are splintering off. And the good thing about that is people are following their hearts and they're finding what they want. The bad thing is, back in the 90s, we were all unified behind one style, 3¾-inch basic figures. There were no Saga Legends. There were no Mission Series. There were no Black Series. You bought what there was. Hasbro sold hundreds of thousands of it, and everybody was happy. Now those numbers are going down. I can't tell you what they are. And it's a very different place to be, and every group has a different opinion and thinks the other group is out to get them, and that is reflected in the questions, too. Because you see people, a lot of people are agnostic, they'll buy what they like. But some people are like, I don't want any more of those Black Series 3¾-inch figures because they're taking away from my 6-inch figures. And I don't want any more of those 6-inch figures because they're taking away from my Saga Legends and Mission Series. And obviously I'm exaggerating in many cases. Some people just live and let live. But there are people who are very upset that what they want isn't happening. But when you hit 1,000 figures, no one will ever agree on anything ever again. And we're way past that.
Yeah, we're at what, like 1,400, 1,500, something like that?
3,000?
3,000?
Yeah.
Wow. That is frightening considering that the Darth Vader that came out with the meditation chamber was about, what, 10 years ago, and that was only the 500?
And actually, it wasn't even the 500. They were beyond 500 at that point.
Oh, well, I thought they might have been.
Yeah, 300 and 500, that was fudged. And one of the reasons I think they stopped doing it is because they don't want to remind people how many figures they bought.
Yeah.
I mean, that is not something you want to do.
I think I can live without that knowledge.
Yeah, I mean, I collect another line called Outer Spaceman, and those are between $10 and $20 each. I just realized I bought 72 of those things. Just like, that's $720 plus shipping, plus some of them are deluxe. Where's my money going? You know, and it's a little upsetting to get to a point when you notice that. But on the other hand, if you can afford it and you're doing well enough that you can get away with it, and or your significant other doesn't seem to pay you that much mind, great, you can continue to get away with it.
Yeah, I think you bring up a great point, Adam, about how a lot of days, nowadays it seems that a lot of collectors seem to just buy it because it's there.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't stand it because personally, like, this is something that was brought up in a recent off-air live stream with the Naboo Starfighter that's been popping up. It was really rare. It had distribution issues, so the Naboo Starfighter, like, really hard to find. And the question was brought up is like, if you found it, would you buy it? And I'm on the side of like, heck no, I would not waste money on a Naboo Starfighter because I don't really care to collect prequel stuff.
But it has an Astromech socket.
Yeah.
You have to. Every ship that has an Astromech socket, you have to buy. Otherwise, you're a bad person. What are you going to do with all the Star Tour droids otherwise? You have to give them a home. Buy every Naboo fighter you can find.
Exactly. It's just, it seems like there's a lot of people, they just collect it because it's rare, not because they actually want it. And I think that's a shame. Produced.
It's a shame, but there's so many fewer of those people nowadays, thanks, because most of them filled up their storage spaces or just got sick of it, and bless their hearts.
There's also sort of a perception that the numbers, I know you probably can't speak of specific numbers, but the numbers or certain figures, especially like EU figures from Star Wars recently, they're relatively rare compared to other things. But I disagree. I think Revan was produced just as much as C-3PO with Salacious Crumb.
Yes.
They were one per pack.
Yes.
It's just the demand is higher for Revan.
I don't know if they were one per pack in every case. Some of the cases had two. I actually have a chart somewhere with all this stuff on it. But yeah, it's all perception. And with video games, you have a different kind of fan. As a video gamer, I'm well aware of this kind of fan. Video game merchandise has historically been uncommon. It's better now. It's better than it's ever been. But if you were a video game fan in the 90s and you wanted a Legend of Zelda or Final Fantasy figure, you were probably not going to find a lot. There were a few things, but you wouldn't. And that audience is used to spending a lot of money on something. There are millions of them now, and they have no problem overpaying for one action figure. So when they see Darth Revan, Darth Malak, Darth Malgus to a lesser extent, they're going to be like, $30? Yeah, fine, no problem. Or they might begrudgingly pay for it, but they're only going to buy one or two Star Wars figures this year, so to them, it's not as big of a deal. Well, for us, it's like, what do you mean I got to pay $15 for a figure? It should be $10. That's absurd. And that's one of the reasons I constantly nag them to reissue those figures, because that audience is out there and it's hungry. And frankly, I want to get them involved in our camp. I want to bring them into the fold. you're going to love Star Wars collecting if you can get what you want. And Knights of the Old Republic was a great way to do it because I don't think I've met anyone who said, I hate that game. I've never played it, so maybe I do. I don't know. But I have not met one person who didn't play that game all the way through and say, I would never buy a figure of that. If they saw it, they'd buy it. And it's all about supply and demand. That's an area where there's more demand than there is supply. I collect other action figure lines. They're manufactured in China, and the production run is 300. They're rarer than any Star Wars figure that'll ever get made. Nobody cares. Nobody wants them. They're worth $15. But that's life. I mean, it's funny to watch these other runs and just how something that really is genuinely rare is worthless because this other video game was so much more popular. There could be tens or hundreds of thousands of that figure, and that's what people decide they want to pay for.
You guys have it. I've got a follow up as far as numbers go, if you don't mind. When we had these distribution problems, is Hasbro far enough in the game? I don't know if you can even answer this, but when they have like the Phantom Menace wave and they sort of overproduce those things, are they already making all the figures for the next like 2-3 waves? So there's already a quantity out there, but the orders don't come in, so they sit somewhere. Is that basically what happened with the distribution issue, or
It's very complicated. There's a lot of ins and there's a lot of outs, and different stores order things differently. Some of that stuff I cannot speak to. But in the case of the big guys, they don't really say, okay, I'm sick of wave one, give me wave two. They just say, just send me, there's like a assortment SKU on the front of the package. If you shop at Target, you ask for a DPCI, that's what that plays to usually. With an exception of the Vintage and Black series, Target did something very strange there, and they should never do it again. But by and large, they just like, give me more Saga Legends guys, and Hasbro sends them whatever's on hand. And the case packs, I think, more than anything else, were part of the problem. They manufacture these things months in advance. I think it's like 60 days between the manufacture date and when they're likely to show up in the store, give or take. It varies. Sometimes it's a couple of months if they hold them on a boat in China or something. But usually this stuff, the case ratios have been decided before anyone knows there's a problem. And it's interesting to look at because, like last year, we saw a lot of Phantom Menace stuff. Back in 2000, I talked to Hasbro at a convention, and they were saying there was a mandate from upstairs that the line had to be changed from Episode 1 to 50-50 or more in favor of the classic trilogy. So Hasbro was aware what Phantom Menace did to a collector group, and they decided to follow Lucasfilm's mandate to continue in that direction, which made sense. I mean, if your licensor says, this is where our advertising dollars are going this year, this is what we're going to do, and this is what you guys should be promoting, you're supposed to do that, and it makes perfectly good sense to do it. And we saw what happened. People just don't like Phantom Menace.
Yeah.
Hi, Kenny. Kenny from South Park, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, I have no idea how they're getting in here, but... Yeah.
Are you here to hijack our feed, sir? I saw your face a second ago. There's really no point in wearing a mask.
Okay. Steve, go ahead.
Famous. I'm just in amazement. I'm in amazement. Okay, that was rough. Okay. Where were we at? I've completely lost my train of thought.
Oh, you were talking about manufacturing problems. I guess changing course is your question. Basically, if you want to change course in an action figure line, Hasbro wasn't lying when they used to tell us it takes 12 to 18 months to make a figure. The case ratio is getting with the factory, stuff like that. If it's you again, you really need to go, sir. Can we kick someone? How does this even work?
Yeah, we can. Yeah, there we go. I don't know where they're coming from.
But long story short, basically, as of last year, in January, if they realized there was a problem, they probably couldn't do anything about it until maybe July, August, or later, depending on how much they had set up in stone. When you negotiate with your factories, there's a lot of stuff that comes up. I mean, I don't know how much in advance is done. And there are aspects of their manufacturing process. I don't know. But if they want to change things and you want to get something else out, it does take a while to change course. It's a pretty big ship to steer and change direction. So now we're at a point where they're correcting course for what happened last year. The problem is a lot of what's happening now was made before they changed course again, and those 3D reissues that we were all promised didn't happen. So we're kind of swimming in a series of compounding change directions. And because of that, the line is probably not doing what it could. At the same time, there is fatigue. I mean, I don't know anyone who's as jazzed today as they were 10 years ago, 15 years ago about this stuff, just because if you look at the line, you're not getting a lot of newness. There's not a lot of freshness. The 6-inch thing is the freshest thing going on, and it's things we already have, just bigger. And they're nice. Mm-hmm. I love them. But where is Jackson? Where is a new Imperial officer? Where is... insert
we,
name here.
How about are we getting that at Kmart, an Imperial officer? The
2-pack.
Yeah, those are due pretty soon.
Yeah. Mm. See, yeah, you might want to address that 6-inch thing and how you think that line is really fresh and good start for you.
It's a good start.
You were missing that before, right?
Yeah. Part of the problem there is when you have there's a first wave syndrome. You again? Oh, you're hilarious.
Someone else.
He was up there before.
Yeah.
But basically, it's a line. Ladies and gentlemen. No, there's two people that keep coming in. Interesting. Yeah.
Sorry about that.
Wave 1 right now is starting to back up, which is good and bad. It's good because hopefully it'll encourage people who didn't know it existed to buy it. The problem is Wave 1 of almost every action figure line that's popular, even Star Wars back in 95, will back up eventually. And without a Wave 2, it'll just die on the vine. So hopefully Wave 1 won't clog to the point where Wave 2 won't hit, because as soon as people get...
Wait.
What? Did you mute him?
Before you block me, can I just say one thing?
If it's Baba Booey rules, I'm going to be very disappointed.
I was just going to say, is my friend here yet?
Yes, I'm here.
No, you're not my friend.
I am here. I'm everyone's friend.
Okay.
Yeah, he's gone.
Yes,
but, yeah. Anyway, long story short, I think it's going to do well. Marvel Legends has continued to do well. Masters of the Universe Classics, several years in, is doing well. And if you're going to pay $10, $15 for a figure anyway, it may as well be taller.
Steve, aren't you thinking of the 6-inch line, like it's a fresh start, you're all in on it, aren't you?
Mm, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'm sort of the mentality where I'm sort of at the limit, as you can tell, from 3 3/4 inch. I don't know that I'm walking into the shops now and I'm finding it difficult to get excited about what's there in the 3 3/4 inch line. The first wave in particular of the Black Series, you know, some of those figures are cool, but they're just very, in my opinion,
cool?
Lazy. I quite like the Clone Pilot. I was hoping to like the Clone Pilot, but when I saw it, I was just like, that is the pain. We're not going to go into that. But but yeah, the first wave for me was just very, go away, you're putting me off.
What the hell? Why do they keep being able to get back in?
Here they are.
He's actually trying to do a YouTube video.
Yes, we are. No, go away.
Is there a way to make this private, or is that not possible?
I have no idea.
At this point, no.
Thank you, Google.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is awesome. Awesome creation.
Flawless creation you have here.
Uh-huh. But yeah, anyway, as I was saying, like I said, with the 3 3/4 inch line, I'm just finding it really difficult to get excited about what's coming out now. I mean, we're getting a couple of new-ish figures in sort of the Pablo, Jill, and Luminara, and Mara in the next wave. But they're really scraping the barrel, I think, with character choices. And for me, it's just, I'm just bored of it, for lack of a better term. So the 6-inch line, even though it's, you know, the figures that are out there are of characters that we've already had in the 3 3/4 inch line, it's a new approach, it's a new dynamic, and I like it, and it's something that for me will cause me probably from now on to boycott the 3 3/4 inch line, because I'm just, as I say, I'm just having a really hard time trying to get excited about it. So, but I don't know, what about you guys? I mean, are you on that same sort of wavelength, or
Adam, are you pretty much a completist? Are you all in on 3 3/4 no matter what they put out?
Well,
I mean,
they really tested me with Shikasta New, just because of the price point. The figure itself is great. My wife's a librarian. Of course I'm going to buy it. But it's going to depend on price more than anything else. I mean, I'm a very price-conscious collector. I will buy something when I think it's the best price it's going to get, usually. I was wrong on Shikasta New. But as long as they continue to make things that are new and interesting, I'll probably buy it. I mean, the first thing I have gone on my way to not buy was Target's Birth of Darth Vader 5-pack out now, or 4-pack, whatever it is, because I can't see anything about it that's different. I don't want to buy it. But I like the Saga Legends guys a bunch. I think those are great. I'm glad they're doing more. Black Series, I'm hoping they kill it off. I think the market of super articulated 3¾ inch action figures is dead. They're not going to continue to keep doing it as the prices go up. It's just not the value proposition isn't there, especially when you're seeing a level of creativity with Wave 1 that's going to cause things to back up, and you're not going to see Wave 3, I don't think. On the shelf, you'll see it. You'll have to order it online. But Black Series, as you said, it's just beautiful. You get that new Sand Trooper. You have three different guns. You can take off the pauldron in the backpack. You got a dirty Stormtrooper. It looks good. It can ride my Battle Cat or my Panther. I just love it, and I want more. I want a Dewback. I want a speeder bike, which we were told we're going to get. If they'll do a Tauntaun, I'm paying. A land speeder, no question. And I want them to do a land speeder so I can like convert it to some magnetic levitation thing and put it on the table in my basement. It's going to be great.
I don't know. I think we all have to eject these guys, otherwise they'll keep coming back, so I don't know if everybody's doing that.
There's my friend here.
Yeah.
I've brought it up several times trying to block this guy, and he keeps popping back. He is a technological wizard.
Yeah.
But there we go.
I just wish he'd moon the camera and get it over with. I mean, that's what he's going to do, right? Just drop Trow and be like, ah, and then that's... If you don't have the balls to do that, at least, I mean, come on, just give it a rest.
Don't tell me.
Do we have any...
No, I want to see somebody moon us. If you have the guts to break into here... I want to see something. I'm going to take a picture of it. I'll find out where you go to school, and I'll send it to your dean. It'll be a ton of fun. And here, let's do it.
So you're thinking that even like Episode 7, that won't be like a refresh or Rebels or a Rebels line or anything like that where people get more excited. There's new characters. There's new things to get. In 3¾, you're saying that Black Series is going to die. Hasbro's going to like lose faith. Is that what you're saying? In like 3¾,
going to
go away? Or has lost faith in it, I guess?
I think they have. That's why we're seeing, if you look across all of their lines, they are pushing more toward a cheaper figure. I picked up some of their Iron Man figures for $6. They're a lot of fun. I like them more than the $10 figures. The Wolverine figures look pretty neat. The new Avengers Assemble figures for $6, not bad. And that's really where you need to be. The problem is that they're feeling out all the audiences to see what'll stick. And I think by this time next year, they would be wise to keep it at, is he going to grin again? Are you going to drop your pants this time, sir? If you're going to moon us, just get it over with. Oh, he looks embarrassed. Look at him smile.
Why isn't this corresponding with your actual live stream on YouTube?
Good question.
Who knows? But I do believe we're going to see a change in direction. If you look at what Funko's doing, too, they've acquired the reaction part of Super 7's business. And they're going to be doing Kenner-style 80s, 70s figures. I think that audience is back because the audience has shrank. The days of people buying 16 of each figure to store in their basement to sell later is over. And because of that, the collector business isn't what it was. So they need to more accurately appeal to what collectors and kids want. So you kind of need a collector line for collectors and a kid line for kids. And the 3¾-inch Black Series line is both and neither. Kids don't want Biggs Darklighter or Ceremonial Luke. Neither do collectors. And that's what they insist on giving us. And obviously, what you see at your local store probably says, we're not interested right now. I bought it. I'm a good supporter of this line, and I want to know what's different, so when people write in, I can tell them. But I can't say I ever had one day in the past 6 years where I said, well, that 30th anniversary Ceremonial Luke figure, boy, I hope they fix the skin tone. Like, not once. It was just like, yeah, it's good enough. Move on to the next one. I'm not a big fan of remake after remake after remake, especially when you see something like the all-new Mara Jade. The other ones weren't great, but this one isn't either.
I think when it's not enough of an upgrade, I think is when you know the problems really start from our point of view. For me, it was like with the Yavin Luke, the fact that they didn't even go to the effort of giving the 30th anniversary collection Luke articulated ankles. That's something they could have done. You know, if they're going to upgrade a figure, upgrade it properly. Don't just give it a new head and expect us to buy it. That's my sort of philosophy on that thing anyway, but...
Yeah, I'm sure it all has to do with development costs, and they're trying to... Hasbro's had a global push to reduce the SKU count across the board, which I think is ridiculous. They want to have fewer products to manage. You want to make more off of less. And then you want to rob a gas station wearing a mask and a baseball hat, because that's the best way to get new figures out in stores. And for the other people watching, the guy keeps coming in, if you didn't see that.
Yeah.
But anyway, I was going somewhere with this. But basically we're just seeing a lot of the same, and after a while, that's all it has to be. Because when you get to a couple thousand figures, again, what can everyone agree that Hasbro would make a fortune with? Maybe a new Boba Fett? Maybe a new Darth Vader? I'd like to see what they can come up with. I mean, the blast effect hand was cool. I like it. Nice accessory. The last Vader I was really excited to buy, though, was probably that Force Unleashed one. And that was 2008.
And I know you got the whole line, the just different enough to make you mad. I know that's sort of like your thing, at least in your figure of the day. So I guess that's a skew into your figure of the day at Galactic Hunter. And how did you decide to start doing that? And it's pretty amazing of how many figures you've done, and you did it pretty much every day, 2006 to just this past year.
Yeah, that's what you call filler. After Revenge of the Sith came out, most of the staff found itself quitting or busy. So I was left basically populating the site for content, which is a lot of how it has been. And this gave the illusion of an active site with lots of people working on it when it was just me. And this is the easiest way to keep things going in what I assumed would be the 3-year death march for Star Wars. I honestly believe Star Wars would be done by 2008. I did not expect it to continue to this point. But with Clone Wars, it got a second lease on life. And with the new movies, a third. And,
oh, dear.
Yeah, it's going to continue for a while, probably.
I don't know why.
When he's having a party.
It doesn't work. So, anyway.
He's having a party on his own.
Mm.
Right.
Bless him.
I want to be invited.
So the Disney acquisition doesn't give you hope that that things will be back and everybody will be happy and the collectors will come back even that are just been jaded for years and years. And
how many second childhoods can a person have is my question. Right now, the audience you want to bring back are the kids who grew up with The Phantom Menace, and I don't know if they want to come back. Action figure collecting is something that came out of a different mentality and a different culture. Today, I have met fewer and fewer collectors who are younger than me. I know they're out there. You guys are here. But it's not like... there were a lot of collectors who are older than I am, like a ton. But younger than me, not so much. I mean, most of the guys older than me, I mean, I came up basically right at the end of the original trilogy. That's when I got into this stuff. And now there's post-trilogy collectors. And there might even be... By now, I guess we probably have some prequel era or late prequel era kids who are fans. But are they going to come back and collect? Can they afford to... would they even want to? I mean, when you was collecting meant buying 100 figures, it wasn't exactly a tall order. Now collecting might mean buying 2,000 figures, 3,000 figures, 4,000 figures. And who's going to do that? I mean, it's daunting. Even the books they put out, they had to put out a book of just 3 2/4-inch action figures. That's not all the Star Wars stuff you can buy. And I remember back when I was a kid, you could buy a 300-page book that had theoretically everything. It's just bonkers. You can't keep on top of all this stuff unless you were alive for it. I mean, between Pepsi cans and Taco Bell wrappers and Angry Birds, whatever, telepods and what have you, there's just a lot of stuff to deal with. And I think since the catchphrase used to be collect them all, that's not something you can do anymore unless you've been doing it or unless you're very, very rich.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Logan, is there any comments or questions in the comment feed at this time? Logan?
Questions in the comments?
Yeah.
I'm not there right now, but if you give me a moment, I can probably get there.
Steve, do you see any? Or you can probably get next thing.
Oh, God.
Not even very well painted,
I'm
sir.
Scared.
You can do better than that.
I'm quaking in my shorts.
I'm just saying, if you're going to get a zombie with a knife through its head, you want to get something that's painted well. If you're going to get the first cheap thing you get at the costume store, you're just going to bore people.
Steve, do you want to go to the next part of the agenda?
Yeah, sure. I think we kind of got through quite a few of those topics with that little bit of the conversation. But I guess the next thing that we could move on to would be how, Adam, do you display your personal collection?
Poorly. I bought a house a couple years ago, finally, And I am still looking for the ultimate solution, because when you only had 100 figures, it was easy. I had this great case for my vintage collection I got off of a guy who made them custom, with foot pegs for every figure, with name tags for every figure, a green felt background, a plexiglass front. You could put all the vintage figures inside, and it was beautiful. That's great when you have 100 figures. I have more than 100 figures now. And I don't have the final answer yet. A couple of years ago, when the Borders book chain went out of business, I bought a bunch of shelves from their store for my stuff. I might be able to make that work, but I still need to come up with some way to keep the dust off of it, because, you know, I don't, dust isn't like a huge deal, but when you're dealing with 2,000 figures, I don't want to ever think about dusting 2,000 figures. So I am still looking for it. Right now, those shelves have, like, TIE fighters and stuff on them. All my vehicles are out, but my figures are not. I got my Outer Spaceman out, my Battle Beasts out, many of my Transformers out, a couple of G.I. Joe items out, Masters of the Universe Classics are out, but the Star Wars figures I haven't come up with a good way yet, just because of the sheer volume of stuff. I'm hoping to find some countertop displays and stuff off of Craigslist, but that has not proven fruitful yet.
So you never, are you, because Hasbro is never going to make some of these like background humans and stuff, are you ever a customizer, like from the cantina, or I don't know, I'm just thinking of a random character, just like one of those spacer guys,
I've had enough conversations with Hasbro to know that it's not worth customizing anything until it's really done, and it's not really done yet, because half the things I say, well, they're never going to make this, eventually we found a way to make happen, like astromech droids. So at this point, I'm happy just to wait and see what they do. There are things that I want. There's one thing I've been lobbying heavily for years, and it might get to a point where I'm going to have to buy a casting or a custom of it, but I do not possess the skill to do that. Those that can are highly talented individuals, aside from those who do it really poorly, you know who you are, but most people do a really, really good job, and it's commendable. But no, I don't do it because I can't. I have a few customs in my collection, but most of them are gifts.
I guess as a segue to that, Steve, you want to go into the thing about Bolshack?
Yeah, I have just closed down my notes by mistake, but just bear with me.
No problem. I'm sorry. But basically, I remember in your early columns, I was back far enough on this, that you actually brought up the fact that Bolshack Older, never going to make Bolshack. And did you, is it really true that, I mean, without you, we would never have seen a Bolshack, or just the entertainment? I guess the question is, like, which figures would we have never seen without your sort of guidance or questioning towards it? The Entertainment Earth exclusives, the Bolshack, or any other things?
I would never say never, because you never know what Hasbro would have done on their own eventually, or what someone else would have done.
Bravo. You can become the next day quarter.
Anyway, it depends on who you ask. Bolshack, I've heard different origin stories from different Hasbro employees. Some said, oh, we're going to do it anyway. Another one said that there were a number of characters onto a list, and they were said, no, no, no. And they're like, well, you know now that people know who this guy is because of this column, right? It's no longer a nobody now. It's a somebody because someone keeps railing against how much they hate him. Let's make him and see what he says. I've heard from one person. Hmm. And other people were just like, oh, we're just going to do it anyway. So I don't know who to believe. Because at first I heard, oh, yeah, it was you. And then I heard, well, maybe not. And then I'm like, well, I'm not going to talk about it anymore. Let's see what story shakes out being true. The Entertainment Earth exclusives, most of those I had a big hand in. The exceptions are the comic packs. That was already ready to go. We just gave them a home. And the Mandalorian set I had very little to do with. There were some notes I had regarding deco and symbols and similarities to existing and other figures and races. But that was mostly Hasbro's idea. I wish I could take credit for it. Honestly, I know some people had a problem with Daryl DePriest getting an action figure. I thought that was awesome. I'm super happy to have a Daryl DePriest action figure, and I hope more people at Hasbro can stick their faces and hide them somewhere in the figures. I think that's super cool. And I've been trying to see if I can find a way to get my boss snuck onto an Imperial officer body, but I haven't made that happen yet. I think that'd be cool, too. But yeah, the Astromech Droids was the first thing I did at Entertainment Earth, because they had another exclusive in development, which I'm not allowed to speak about. Don't worry, you wouldn't have wanted it anyway. But I came in and they go, oh, we're going to make this. And I'm like, that's terrible. This is what I want you to make. This is what you need to do. And it was very close to my original notes. But Hasbro obviously did the coloring and everything. I just said, here are the robots I want you to do. Here are the molds I would like you to use. Let me know what you think. And only one of them that I asked for at the 11th hour didn't make the cut. But they eventually did make it as R3M3. At the time, I think it was R301 because of the trading cards or something. They change the names on these guys every couple of years, depending on what book you read, what trading card you buy, and who you ask.
There was a couple that were sort of off from the movies in those packs. So there was the one from like Dex's Diner. I can't remember the names off the top of my head, but there's like
a green.
Yeah, R4A2, and then the one in Mos Eisley that just sort of roams the street with like a red deco.
I think it was R3T3.
Yeah, they don't quite match the films as well as some of the others. Is that a sort of, I mean, that's not a near court. That's like that's not what you told. You said look at the.
I just said I just said here's the character I want. Make it, and they did.
Right.
That's why like R2X2 was something that people had a lot of arguing over, because if you ask me what color R2X2 is, I would say black. But other people said, no, he's green. And I guess depending on what version of the movie you had or what trading card you were looking at, your eyes can tell you something else. So eventually we got both, and I think that's fantastic, because it's like the green clone trooper in the new Black Saga wave. There's the barf green that they use now, which General Giant used, which I thought was correct, and then Target used their Crayola-ish green. Hasbro had the Crayola-ish green that they used on the Clone Wars version, the Entertainment Earth Clone Trooper version, which I consulted on, and some of the other ones. Are we going to do this again? Do you have a new joke this time? So when you guys are kind of... Guys, are you able to edit out portions, or is it?
I'm trying to.
Do that, yeah.
Oh, it's asking if I want to block somebody. Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
I think we all have to block them, or otherwise they keep coming back. Like everybody who's
blocking you. Yeah,
Roscoe. Permanently block and ignore. Yes, please. No, that's great.
Yeah, I think that's why they come back. Is if we don't all do it, then they can come back.
Okay.
Okay, I didn't know that. Thank you. I'm sorry.
We'll try blocking him.
Yeah, it worked. What are you doing?
Well, hopefully, at least for a few minutes.
Until I create another
alt. Yeah, here's our next 30 seconds of peace.
Logan, did you see any questions in the comments, or do you have any questions yourself?
No, I wasn't able to get to the comments because my computer really slows up when I'm doing these live calls, so... I don't want to try and risk getting kicked off the call because my computer is being very slow. But, it's been, I've just really had a blast just listening to your guys' questions and hearing Adam's responses. So I don't really have anything that hasn't been previously covered.
Steve, go ahead.
Okay. I think we're just about done with the topics. So if you just wanted to move into the last portion, or if you've got anything else that you want to add.
I guess the one other thing as far as the Star Wars websites, Galactic Hunter, you joined that quite early. Mm-hmm. Maybe you can't comment on this, but I believe it was sort of spun off of Rebel Scum.
You don't bet.
Done. There we go.
He's back on.
I just blocked him. Oh, there's another one. Great.
Bursty Pig!
Again.
Bursty Pig! Bursty Pig!
How you doing, Ben?
I would love to try whatever they are on.
Pixie sticks.
Yeah, we'll fix this. I guess the comment is this is something maybe you may or may not talk about, but I guess Galactic Hunter came out of spin-off of Rebel Scum, or wouldn't you say that? And recently there's been sort of a couple other things that the people that were used to be on Rebel Scum are not anymore, are affiliated, or Force.net. There was Dan Curto and James Burns, who spun off and did their own podcast when they used to be on the Forcecast. And then Jimmy Mack and Jason Swank, they both did Rebel Force Radio, and they used to be on the Forcecast as well. And sort of seems like a lot of spin-offs from Rebel Scum, and I don't know if you can comment on that or you know anything about the whole thing.
I can tell you what. I worked at Rebel Scum, and then I got another offer at Yak Face. I went to Yak Face, and then at Yak Face, I got another offer when Galactic Hunter was starting, and I went to Galactic Hunter. I have very little interaction with other collector sites, to be honest with you. I don't pop up in the forums much. I'm always kind of been more of a push out and do my own thing kind of thing, because, like, you know, whenever, anytime you work on a site, when you have people discussing stuff behind the scenes, it often takes away from being able to actually
do
whatever it is you want
to
do.
Better to
and,
talk about
doing things like Figure of the Day. You know, you write thousands of columns. You can't let that stuff stop you from doing whatever it is you want to do. As such, I really couldn't tell you what's going on, specifically what's going there, but, you know, everyone has different ideas of what they want to do and different directions they want to go in. And just gives you an opportunity to do your own thing. Now that anyone can do a show, thanks to Google Hangouts and other technologies, anyone can start a show. And if you have an idea to do something better, you can. Back in 95, I did my Star Wars newsletter because the action figure magazines, that like Tomarts and Lee's that I loved, weren't giving me information as quickly or as specifically as I wanted. So I figured, well, if I'm not getting what I want, other people might not be either. So let's give them something unique. And right now everyone has a chance to say, okay, well, I work on this site. I can't do what I want to do. I'll do my own thing. And that's great. The problem is there may be more people doing stuff than there are people who want to watch it. And that's something I've seen in other action figure lines I collect, again, like Outer Spacemen. Those figures are made in runs of 300. I think like at least 10% of them are reviewed. Maybe more, which is kind of funny and kind of sad. It's just like, well, it's a toy line for people who write about toys on the internet, maybe, and it's a different kind of an audience. The idea of people who collect because they like Star Wars has mutated into people who collect because they run a Star Wars site. There are people who do it because they love it, but a lot of people are writing about it now, too, which is a really different way to perceive this all happening.
True story.
And I'm looking forward to seeing what'll come out of the next 5 to 10 years. I'm surprised more people haven't given up on blogging and writing and covering this stuff, to be honest with you. It's great to see there's an endless amount of enthusiasm and free hosting services for this stuff, because otherwise you wouldn't be able to see all these new columns and opinions come up, and that does let, since Hasbro won't market it, we'll do it.
Yeah. And you actually run a YouTube channel as well, or is other people involved with that, the Galactic Hunter?
That's all me. It doesn't do as well as I would like. People like reading my stuff. They don't like hearing me talk.
But you do have a nice brief review style, I guess you'd say, where you just are a couple minutes, you're not like going on 15 minutes about one figure.
I saw a lot of Transformers video reviews where I just had like a simple question, like, you know, I want to see how this one step in the transformation works. And the video is 15 minutes, and I don't want to watch it. So with my video reviews, what I did is I took the videos and stills first and added the voiceover later, which makes it more hurried. But on the bright side, that means you've already edited the video before you even start talking, which is great, because that way, like back in the day, Kenner would make a commercial that could tell you everything you need to know about Han Solo, a scout trooper, and a speeder bike in 30 seconds. We do not have that skill because we are not in commercial editing, but we should aspire toward that because they don't have all day. They don't care. They just want to know, like, should I buy this? And the faster we can tell them that, the better. I mean, I'm sure someone's going to do something when they're going to be holding up a figure and go, yes, and that's the whole video. But like, I've seen unboxing videos that are embarrassing. They make me feel bad that someone's going to look at that and go, oh, that's probably what that Paulus guy does. It's like, no, I don't spend 15 minutes videotaping a cardboard box with a knife being cut open. Why are we showing this? I mean, it's just, it gives people a platform to do whatever they want, and whatever makes them happy, I want them to do. On the other hand, I don't want to see people cutting open a cardboard box. I can't think of anything less exciting.
Some people might like it.
They're wrong.
Guilty as charged.
Guilty as charged? Oh, no.
You are wrong.
Yeah. I guess I get away with it because it's about 5 years since I've done one, so I'm all right.
But you've learned from your mistakes. That's the important part. I mean, we all did goofy things when we were younger.
I wouldn't even read my own newsletters. Come out of the box. So.
But yeah, just the unboxing thing. It's an interesting phenomenon. It's always curious to see what aspects of our collector culture are going to survive. You know, because of YouTube hosting everything, this stuff's going to stick around. But Usenet managed to get kicked in the can because of what I believe to be false allegations regarding pornographic.
Right, guys, WhatsApp, don't get annoyed.
And,
don't get an orgasm, but you guys will have to check this out. You guys, WhatsApp, don't get an orgasm.
You know, culturally speaking, WhatsApp, this is what's going to be probably retained. Like,
don't
this show today,
guys,
with everybody interrupting, is probably going to be on YouTube forever. But I couldn't tell you what happened to all my old newsletters. They're gone. Mm-hmm. Unless they're in somebody's email box from 15 years ago. It's backed up somewhere.
They never deleted their email.
Yeah, maybe it's there somewhere. I don't have them. It's probably for the best.
Yeah, I was looking... I was actually looking in the Wayback Machine trying to find like some of your earliest works just to see what I could find. And I mean, you have to have to know the site name, and I guess I don't know what your website was at the time. I knew Rebel Scum, so I found some of your old Q&As from that, but I couldn't find your newsletters.
Yeah. I'll send you a URL to the old website URL you might be able to find in the Wayback Machine. That was just me goofing around with it must have been like 5 or 10 gigs of hosting space my ISP provided back then. Back when that mattered on dial-up, we're like, ooh, 5 megabytes, I can do anything with this.
There are a few questions in the chat here. I just got to the chat. I don't know if anybody else is in that, but LegoMaster Cole 583 says, do you think the Entertainment Earth will have any more exclusives in the near future?
Partially because of what I said earlier about the diversity in taste, it's going to be harder and harder to do because you have to make a very large number of an item, and everybody has to agree it's what they want. And that may not exist in 3¾-inch anymore. I'm always looking for opportunities for all kinds of stuff. Entertainment Earth is also doing a lot of their own manufacturing and working with another company called Biff Bang Pow on other licenses. And right now, there's a little bit more focus there. Star Wars is excruciatingly important to us. But... if Hasbro wants you to do a certain thing a certain way, and you want to do a certain thing a certain way, and there's dollar issues and all that other stuff, short answer is I don't have a good item that I want to do right now, and we haven't been approached with one lately, so don't bet on it. There probably will be some form of Star Wars exclusive soon, but I don't know it'll be Hasbro. I think the last one we had was the Scout Trooper being attacked by Ewoks and a giant maquette, which was one of my pitches, inspired in part by a Topps trading card from the 90s that I really liked.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Steve?
Uh-huh, yep. We're at the
miscellaneous topics.
Yeah? Okay, yeah, that's cool. The first topic that I'd listed was, I guess in some ways it harkens back to what we were talking about earlier with the repacks and the upgrades that Hasbro keep putting out, and that's the Republic gunship from the Vintage Collection. And I just really wanted to get everybody's thoughts on that, especially considering we found out what figures were going to be packed in with that vehicle this past week. I just wanted to get your guys' thoughts on that.
I guess I'll go first.
Does anybody have thoughts?
Okay, it's still cheaper than it is to get a gunship on eBay. That's a big mark in the pro column. I've never been a big fan of exclusives being marked up by their retail partner to the point where it is similar to eBay. I don't know how much of that's manufacturing. I don't know how much of that's Toys R Us. Like a few years ago, we found out that the 12-inch Dubak cost was significantly lower than what Toys R Us was charging for it. Don't know if that's the case on this one. But it's about $30 too expensive. And the figure, I'd say count your blessings that it's not necessarily something you want. The Clone Pilot is different. Not necessarily different enough that you'd want it, but it is different. Yoda doesn't look that much different, and the Clone Trooper, inconsequential. But for those wanting a gunship, at least provides an opportunity, and it'll probably be $30 cheaper in about a month and a half anyway, with the big toy book promotion Toys R Us does every year. And I'll be buying one, but not necessarily yet. I have a Toys R Us credit card, so I get those certificates in the mail. I got like $35, $45 worth of expire Monday, so I have to decide right now if I want to use it toward that or not. And I might. But I appreciate they put it out again. I think it's great. I think it's unfortunate that they are attempting to use the fetishization of vintage-style packaging to mark items up, it probably should be $5-$10 cheaper. But it's also unfortunate that we fall for it every time. It's not really vintage. It's nice. Real vintage stuff is real vintage stuff. This is, in the grand scheme of things, not... It doesn't have a history behind it. It hasn't survived years in hot basements and humid attics. And it's just something you can buy at the store. So it's cute, but it's not... It lacks the emotional attachment that people my age at least have, and some of your guys' age, have toward the stuff that was out there for years and years and years. If you can just make a new one, it's no longer special. And in the case of a gunship, it's attempting to evoke a sense of nostalgia. You know, it's hearkening back to an era that didn't exist. There was never an Attack of the Clones gunship in a vintage packaging. It's cute. It's nice. But given that in another style, I'm sure this looks better. But if they put it in a window box, they'd probably sell more. And marked it down about $50.
Yeah. MKM, what do you think of that topic?
I mean, stuff over here is just always a bit harder to come by. And are you blocked him yet? I mean, stuff over here is always a bit more harder to come by because we haven't got the same shops over here. So we got mainly Toys R Us, and like I said earlier, you're getting the TIE Interceptor there, which is in the vintage style packaging. And
are they stocking the Slave One there at Toys R Us too, you guys?
No, I don't. Steve,
not yet. Anyway, I don't know whether it's coming here, but it's not. It's not here at the moment.
No, it's on Logan's shelf, right behind him.
Yeah, he's bought more.
Makes me very happy, even though I paid too much for it. Going back to what Adam said about paying for the packaging.
So are you not in for the gunship then, the vintage gunship?
No, I wouldn't be. I mean, I've got a vintage, I've got the Clone Wars version, the one with the teeth on it, and I got that at Argos years ago for a tenner in the box, so. I mean, I don't really collect ships at all, so. I mean, back in 95, 96, I collected quite a lot of the Powder Force ships, but since then, I just haven't got the space, and a lot of them are just reissues or, you know, slightly improved, so...
Repaints.
Yeah, repaints. I mean, I've got a Jango Fett Slave 1 in the blue packaging, so that's from about 10 years ago. I've got that for a tenner as well, so... Yeah. I tend to buy ships when they're cheap, so...
I'm not drawn into it, just basically because I have a gunship. But actually, I didn't get the gunship back until 2003. I just got it last year for a good price. I paid $30 and it had all the pieces. I'm a loose collector, so I got it. I'm not really drawn to this too much. I don't really have any room for it, so I'm probably going to pass too. But I do like the Falcon or the original trilogy vehicles because they are kind of like there is a real Falcon from back then. But unfortunately. Adam, wasn't that priced like double the price that it came out on Legacy?
It was usually about 180. I think it was 180, 150 when it came out on Legacy, and it was 250 at first on Vintage, but there were markdowns where it was down to 230, 220 around there.
I got mine on the 50% off sale. They did a cyber sale, so it was like only 125, which I think is a really good price for the big Millennium Falcon.
Very reasonable.
Over here, I mean, the big... Falcon that in the Legacy that I mean I saw that in a few shops going for about £250, which is must be what $300 even more. So I mean that was really expensive and very scarce as well.
I actually got mine at the Midnight release when it was Midnight Madness back in 2008, and I picked mine up for, I think when they first hit over here, the general retail price for him was $150. So then to see it obviously inflate a little bit when it got a new box, you know, it was a bit of a whoa, what are you doing?
Yeah.
Well, not just the new box. I mean, between 2008 and 2010-11, manufacturing costs in China went up, and I don't know if you guys follow this stuff, but the Chinese minimum wage is going to be doubling, like, between what it was a year or two ago and the next two or three years. It was a clone of, like, $3,000 a year, and it's going up to about $6,000 a year in whatever U.S. dollars were at the time. And that's one of the reasons everything you see is going up to be so much. It's not just because, you know, resources like paper and oil and labor is a big part of it. And unfortunately, the robots are only doing so much for us right now. Lego in Mexico is having a lot of automated stuff when it comes to packaging and measuring out those pieces and stuff. But Hasbro and the action figure market hasn't really been able to embrace automation as much. And there aren't many lines other than like Hot Wheels, which for some magical reason keeps those things at a dollar. No matter what, those things are like a dollar, maybe a dollar ten in the U.S. We really need to see something in that direction happen because, you know, we see these vehicles go up a lot when they're reissued. Even the gunship, I mean, when that first gunship came out, it was 40. The second issue of it for Clone Wars was 30. Then it hovered around 50, 60. Now it's 130. Part of that might be Toys R Us. Part of that might be the pack-ins. But a big part of that's going to be the fact that Hasbro's factories in China are, you know, the Chinese factories, I think, can only be no more than like 49% owned by a foreign investor. So they're still owned by Chinese factories. They have various Chinese labor laws to adhere to, including wage, which obviously they deserve and should have. But and as cynical as this sounds, we've been exploiting other countries for our collectibles for quite some time, and we might have run the gamut of what we can exploit out of this one. We got to find a better way to do things or stop exploiting people, which I think is also a very viable thing to look into. I don't want to put anybody out of work, but there would be some advantages to seeing what else we can automate or at least find a way to do where we can pay people better for what we ask them to do and hopefully at the same time pay less for our goods.
So these, like, I guess as a follow-up to that, so these $6, these lower articulated things that Hasbro's making for Marvel, for Star Wars, those, because of these minimum wage laws and all those factors, by like 2015, 16, we might be paying $10 for a single one of those. And
I wouldn't bet on it. The strategy there right now is a little bit different. All those $6 figures are meant to be things that are mass appeal. So with things like Black Series, I believe, and again, this is me saying I believe this, it may not be true, Hasbro is accounting on a lot of mold reuse and collectors rebuying the same thing. And at the same time, they're aware what those numbers are. They're very optimistic on those smaller figures that they'll be able to sell more at a lower price. And the more you sell, you know, volume is a big deal in the manufacturing industry. If you make enough of something, it'll be really cheap. Back in the 1980s, a story from a Hasbro executive, I think it was in Toy Wars, said that the 3¼-inch G.I. Joe packaging cost more than the 3¼-inch G.I. Joe figure. And because they managed to get that price down so much. And if Hasbro really, really wanted to, and they got people really, really on board with action figures again, I don't know that that's going to happen. The price could even stay the same or go down. You'll never see a super articulated figure for $5 again, I don't think. I could be wrong. But seeing what kids are into these days, yeah, I really doubt that that'll happen. But on the other hand, if the 5-point of articulation figure hits $10, that's kind of a non-starter, unless it's a figure. If there's a character all you guys want that you don't have yet, you'd pay $10 for it. But would you pay $10 for a non-articulated Stormtrooper? Eh, probably not. Hmm. Or maybe one, but not two. Hmm. Or six, 12, 28,
37. I was going to say, I think for me, with the, at least with the Saga Legends stuff, it's to me, that's got some element of a nostalgic feel to it with the limited articulation. I mean, especially like with the Stormtrooper and stuff like that, we don't get sort of vintagey, if that's a real word, figures these days. So to get something that is like that, that does, you know, it's not in any intentional throwback to that era, but you know, it adds that, if that makes sense. So I like it from that aspect. I mean, everybody's been going crazy about this Saga Legends line, but some of them are done pretty poorly, I'll admit. Like the Yoda, it's not great, but. But then some of them are done really well. I think the sculpts on the clones are fantastic, and the Jango Fett and all that kind of stuff. So if the figures are still good at the end of the day, just because they don't move, they're going to be standing on a shelf for the most part. So
yeah, I mean, that's one of the funny things I always had a problem with people. No offense to the card collectors out there, but if you're a card collector and you're complaining about articulation, your opinion means nothing to me. Mm. If you don't help in that figure, I really don't care what you think, because that's nice that you think it's important, but if it doesn't, your interaction with that figure, it's immaterial. And that's one of the reasons I like the Saga Legends guys so much, is one of the problems with, if you collect other figure lines, you'll notice, especially with the bigger ones, gravity and heat make your figures want to fall over. over time it'll make it just a little bit softer, maybe just a tiny little bit every day, to the point where it jumps off your shelf and does a nosedive. With the 5-point of articulation figures, the only joints that are going to move are the waist joints, and it's much easier to find the sweet spot, that center of gravity where he's not going to fall. And even with display stands, battle droids will fall over time just because of how they were designed, unless you have a waist clip stand, or like you can buy those at Craft Mart or something. So this new style of figure is much more collector-friendly than some people would care to admit. I think some people, what they really mean is, I want a figure that I want to pose how that figure looks. Ultimately, deep down, I think a lot of these people want statues, but they don't want to admit it. They just want to have control over exactly how it looks, and I can appreciate that. I mean, you want your figure to not look dorky. But having grown up with that original 70s and 80s line, I never once said, oh, this figure's terrible, I need to have an elbow joint. I knew people that did, but I always felt they were, you know, this is a Star Wars figure, and I like Star Wars figures. I've got my original Kenner Bubba Fett I bought off one of my friend's neighbors on my desk in front of me right now, and it is what it is, and I like it. And I'd rather have more figures be able to stand. I love my Masters of the Universe classics, but I got to pick up Drago Man every now and again. I got to pick up, Man-at-Arms when he falls over, and I've got a display stand for him, and that's irritating. I don't want to do that. I want to enjoy my figures. I don't want to have to tend to them like I would a garden. You know, I don't want to have to prune them and adjust them and make sure they're just so they don't fall over. I want them to stand. I paid $30. I want the figure to stand up, damn it, and I don't want to have to mess. I got thousands of these dumb things. I have better things to do all day than when I take my figure off the shelf. I want to have one of it and put it back. I don't have to worry about it becoming the domino rally that's going to knock down hundreds of dollars worth of plastic.
Yeah, totally agree.
That's what scares me about Black Series, because my Sand Trooper will not stay standing. And as a bonus thing about Black Series, I don't know how many of you guys know this, but the footholes are not consistently sized. The two of the figures have footholes of the same size as Hasbro's Marvel Legends. Two of the figures have footholes of the same size as 1978 to 1985, and then on Kenner figures. So you couldn't make one peg-sized display stand to fit all the figures at all. You're probably going to need to use doll stands.
Okay.
This is what keeps me up at night.
Did you have one more topic there?
Yeah, it was while we were on the subject of things not coming out. I think it was the because they brought out the concept art, didn't they, recently for the Star Wars 1313 game that we should have been getting but aren't. So again, I don't know if any of you guys managed to check the. I think it was IGN that posted an article on this. And they, as I said, they shared some concept art and stuff like that. And again, just wanted to get everybody's thoughts on it because I thought it was awesome and it kind of depressed me a little bit. I mean, I'm not a gamer, but to see all that concept art, to see what could have been, it was a little bit, you know, it was a bit upsetting, really. So yeah, I just wanted to get your guys' thoughts on that.
People emotionally seem to put a lot of emphasis on what's behind the curtain they can't have and what's under the box they can't see. Like for years and years, like deleted scenes for Star Wars, we all pined over seeing those for years, and now with the Blu-rays we've seen them and they weren't that great. With Star Wars 1313 and Star Wars software as a whole, it really is a toss-up. For every Knights of the Old Republic you get, you might get a, I think it was Yoda Stories, or I love the Super Star Wars
Adventures.
What, sorry, what was that?
Clone Wars Adventures game.
I actually didn't mind that one so much. I got it for $5 on Amazon, but maybe that's why. But when you have something, see this, you can't have it, is another thing I've been fond of saying in Q&A, because whenever, like the holographic Newt Gunray figure is a fine example. No one, if they made a holographic Newt Gunray, would be really excited about it. They'd buy it, it's different, they'd be like, oh, okay. But because they can't have it, they want it twice as much. With Star Wars 1313, with Boba Fett, it's exponentially more enticing. And it's always a little, it makes me nervous too, because what would it have been like? Would Daniel Logan have been Boba Fett? Would it have been that voice that we don't care for as much? Well, the older people may not care for as much. I don't want to speak for you guys. I don't know what your opinions are in Boba Fett's voice. But, when I watched the DVDs and Blu-rays of the original trilogy, I was like, that's not Boba Fett's voice. And with a video game, that'd probably be it, too. And when you have a character like Boba Fett, so much of him is not what Lucasfilm told you. There's a little bit of the marketing stuff from 78 and 79, little hints, and you created that character. Boba Fett is in your imagination, and anyone who tells you anything else is always going to be wrong. So what you saw in Attack of the Clones is wrong. What you saw in Clone Wars is wrong. Whatever you see in the next movie is wrong, because you have a relationship with that character that is so intimate, and it's so you, that there's nothing they can ever do that will match your emotional attachment to him. Well, Luke and Vader, you kind of know who they are and what they're all about. Boba Fett was such a blank canvas for you to project your hopes and dreams on of whatever you want that character to be. They'll never match it. You know, what you love is what you're going to love, and it'll always be that way. When I was a kid, I had no real conceptions of Boba Fett because I grew up after that mail-in offer, and after everyone said, he's going to be the major villain in Star Wars 2, and it's going to be great. And, oh, he hates Han Solo and Chewbacca. I mean, to me, he was just a dude in a suit who showed up for 5 minutes and got eight until I was older, and I found out what all of you older guys projected onto him, and I found that fascinating. But, I mean, I think it's for the best that they canceled it because you get to hope again. You get to dream again. You get to pretend that it could have been a great thing, and that hope will make you like the character even more because they took something away from you. So, in a way, I think the best thing we can do here is thank Disney and LucasArts for making sure we couldn't
get the game.
We don't get the game, but you don't get to be upset by it either. And it's a toss-up. It's kind of sad. But on the bright side, you get to come away from the whole situation loving Boba Fett a little bit more, and there's no chance they can hurt what you already love about the character. It's going to be with you still. You still get to love Boba Fett as you love Boba Fett. It'd be nice if they could expand the character in a way we could all agree is awesome. But other than Andy Mangles, nobody can do it. No, that's Boba Fett, Twin Engines of Destruction, the greatest Boba Fett Star Wars comic book ever printed.
I remember, I'd have to agree with that's you there. Good. Joker Fett, you might want to speak to that since you're actually, that your name is Joker Fett.
After Adam's little elaboration on it, and I actually do kind of find myself agreeing with him, is that Boba Fett is, you kind of take what you see of him in the movies, what you may have read of him in the comics, and you just kind of, it's two parts, actual, official, like canon, but then there's always that part that's just your input, the character. Like, it's the people difference, like, people who think of Boba Fett as the guy, as the big bad bounty hunter, and people who think of Boba Fett as, you know, kind of the anti-hero more, you know, he with the kind of rugged justice. So it really is just like kind of everybody's Boba Fett is different. So I do like that, and kind of draw an analogy here is that it's like if Marvel, I know we're on a Star Wars chat, but if Marvel announced that they were canceling Iron Man 3 before it came out, and we all saw what Iron Man 3 did to the Mandarin if you're a Marvel fan, so maybe it would have been better if Iron Man 3 just never came out.
I have to disagree with you on the Mandarin.
Of course, there would have been a lot of people who would be upset over that.
Go ahead.
People who would have been upset over cancellation, but then, you know, we would never have done that.
There were Logan's lagging on a little bit there.
Logan is experiencing.
I think it's an interesting take on the Mandarin. I mean, I've been familiar with the character. I know what he is, but in a post-American world, when you have a character like the Mandarin, and frankly, the box office in China, you have to be really careful. It's a very sensitive area to be treading in. And, you know, the whole Fu Manchu mystic Chinese man thing, it is what it is, and America's culture evolves, and we have different takes on what you can say about different groups and stuff over time, and it had to evolve. And what was already there probably wouldn't have done what it should have for the character, and you can't kill the goose that lays the golden egg. And if you're going to do something and you can't do it right, at least do it really goofy. And they did it really goofy, and for me that worked, because it's just like, well, how can you take it? The whole terrorist thing, I mean, it is, we've been through so much in this country, not necessarily for the best, and it's just, it's great to think that somebody would have fun with it instead of being, oh, big bad man wants to blow us all up. It's like, no, he's just some drugged out guy who's trying to have a good time and get some action. It's like, you know what? Yeah, why not? I mean, it's so much more refreshing rather than having to deal with somebody who has some preconceived notions over, like, Western imperialism. I found it amusing, and it was an interesting take on a character. I understand why people are upset, but, again, your Mandarin will always continue to exist in the comic books, the cartoons in the 90s, in other media. So, I don't know. I agree with you, but I'm also very happy with what we saw.
It's that way with everybody talking about the expanded universe lately and the fact that it might change and it might go away. Well, it's never going to go away. The books are still there. They're not going anywhere.
Yeah. There's always going to be continuity errors.
That's the main gripe I've always had with any new Star Wars material. It's always been the fans that sit there and say, this is going to ruin Star Wars. It's not going to ruin Star Wars. It's going to probably not meet your expectations of what you wanted this new material to be, but it's not going to ruin what's already there. So just either enjoy it or don't enjoy it. You know, you don't have to accept it. Just it is what it is. But yeah.
You know, I love the old Marvel Star Wars comics. I know they're terrible, but I love them. Mm. I like the old Adam West Batman show. It's terrible, but I love it.
Cheesy Batman.
I disagree with you on being terrible all the way through on the Marvel comics.
Oh, no. I mean, the Lumaya stuff and the guy I thought were great. The idea of, it was fun to see the anime and manga artist inspiration of the race names. I like the Hoojibs. I want a Hoojib figure. I've asked for Hoojib figures. I don't have a Hoojib figure, but I want one. There's so much material in there, and it's a shame that they didn't make a transition to television.
If they'd had like a year worth of Marvel figures, I'd go for them.
But I don't think it would sell to anyone but you and me, but I would be very happy. I'd even buy
holiday special figures for a year. So
that'll never happen.
Wookiee family.
Yeah. The Wookiee family, I think, is possible. The Boba Fett was great to see. And I guess Zutton, technically. But, we'll see. I mean, with the new stewardship of the franchise, it's going to be interesting to see how Disney treats what George Lucas wants us to see versus what we know to be true. And, like, the DVDs are a great example of that. What's Disney's opinion? And what are they contractually required for their opinion to be? What is the Star Wars movie? What's in it? Which cut should we be seeing? Is there somewhere in between the DVD cut and the theatrical cut? Do I have to hear the voice? It's not. It was Jason Wingren for Boba Fett, right? In the Empire? Will he be back? I hope so. Will we have the option? Even better. It's great that we can select our own personal canon, and bless your hearts, Hasbro, for that Luke Lumaya 2-pack. I couldn't be happier. But I want more. We all want more. I think that's really what it all boils down to and why we're all here today. No matter what they make, it'll never be enough.
Exactly. I guess my take, Steve, on the video game, I'm always behind on video games, so it looks cool.
Yeah, me too.
I never would get to it in the immediate future. I've yet to play Knights of the Old Republic, even though I bought it like 3-4 years ago. So
yeah, likewise.
So I eventually get to it, but generally when I want to play video games, I go and I look at my selection, and I'll go to Ms. Pac-Man, even though I played it a million times. Because I know it's quick and I can do it, some of these games take way too much time. So.
Have you played Pac-Man Championship Edition DX?
I have not.
It's the greatest thing in the world. It's like caffeine plugged right into your brain. It is the best Pac-Man game since the 1980s. It's fantastic. If you have an Xbox, PSN, I think it's on Steam.
Really?
Run, do not walk. Download a demo if you can. Pac-Man Championship Edition DX. Or they just put an update to it a week ago. It is preposterously fun. That is my absolute most important off-topic plug that I give you today.
Oh, that's cool. Great.
I love that game so much.
Maybe that's what all the guys that kept joining our call earlier were playing. That's why they were so happy.
Oh, man, you have no idea. It's like that. I have not had more fun with any arcade game than that. I love it so much. I don't even want to play Classic Pac-Man ever again. That's how much more I like it. It's so great.
That's good to know, Adam.
And there's a 5-minute time limit on it, too, or 10 minutes, so that way it's like points in a certain amount of time, and the level changes. And it's off topic, but you try it. Please try it. Tell me what you think of it. I wanted to know if you like it.
Yeah, sure, I'll do that. Anything else, Steve? Otherwise, I've got sort of a final question we can go off. Or
yeah, go ahead then, Don. You take it.
Okay. I guess the final thing is what do you see? How do you see like your future collecting future? Since there's so much that you've collected and you've collected since you were a kid, like you said, do you feel like you'll be always out there? I mean, that's part of your job now, so we'll be seeing you in 2030, 2040, still blogging and posting on GalacticHunter.com and being out there on the internet and talking about toys.
As long as Mike at Galactic Hunter gives me a home, I will be there. When he decides to hang it up, I will continue my nomad ways and find a new home, wherever that'll be, I don't know. The biggest change I've seen in the last couple of years is Kickstarter. I don't know how many guys follow that. There's a line of minifigures that I love to pieces from October Toys called OMFG. It's an outlandish minifigure, guys. It's a take on the muscle figures that were sold in the 1980s, which were based on the Kinnikuman Keshi figures sold in Japan. They're basically unpainted little artist figures. It combines urban vinyl, which I like but is expensive, with minifigures, which I like and are cheap. So you can get these, like, you put $10 down on Kickstarter, they make 300 or whatever sets of these things. They're very limited. They're great. And they're yours. And you had a hand in making them. And we just saw the Four Horsemen do that with their Ravens figures for the first time. I don't know how many guys are familiar with that. But they're beautiful. I saw the prototypes in person 2 years ago, and I think I must have pledged $200 to get a flamingo and a duck, Minotaur the duck, with a Viking helmet. It's awesome. And it'll be out next year. But right now, my biggest fear is the splitting of the fan base. We've seen Star Wars, you know, break off into little factions. And now with Kickstarter, anybody can make stuff that wants to. If you have a contact in China that can do stuff in minimal manufacturing skills, there's nothing stopping you right now from making a Wampa Cave. You just can't call it a Star Wars Wampa Cave, but it can be a Wampa Cave, and it can have places for Luke's feet, and you can hang upside down, and you can make it with no trademark or copyright issues.
Ice Monster Cave.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at Transformers, they are skirting dangerously close to various character infringement, but no one has shut them down over at iGear and the third-party places. I don't know if it's different enough. I am not a lawyer. I do not know the facts behind this. I think they do nice work. I haven't bought any myself, but they make an Optimus Prime figure that is clearly Optimus Prime, but it doesn't have an Autobot symbol on it, and somehow they still can legally, or at least they can produce it. I don't know the law. I don't profess to know the law. And as we go forward, we're probably going to start seeing people look at Star Wars and seeing what they can do with it beyond that. I mean, in the 90s, they did the microphones for the Joe Yauza and Cy Snoodles 2-pack. I think whatever the store associated with figures.com was had them.
Yeah.
That sort of thing is a wide open avenue. And if Hasbro continues to go the direction it's going with fewer products, fans are going to get bored. Fans are going to have a little too much time to think, and fans are going to start making their own stuff. So it wouldn't surprise me to see a desert landscape or a gun rack for stormtroopers. I mean, we can make pretty much whatever we feel like and in smaller quantities. It's just a matter of risk and time and desire. The funeral pyre a few years ago is a fine example of something I railed against. I think it was a terrible idea because it would have been like $40-$50. But if you really want a funeral pyre for your 3¾-inch action figures, nothing is stopping you. We can make them. We can manufacture it in China. We can have light-up flames. We can make it out of wood if we want. We can do whatever we want. But no one took that step. So, you know, maybe it isn't something we really want.
We kind of discussed this briefly a little bit last week, didn't we, Dan, when we were talking about what Galactic Merchants are doing at the minute with their 3¾-inch display environments. They've just put together an Indiegogo campaign, managed to reach the target to get the sets made that they wanted to get made. And they're doing the block, just very small segments to display your figures in. They've done one that's the Death Star corridor with the little on the containers and stuff like that, and they've done the Blockade Runner as well. Again, they originally started out, we're going to call this Blockade Runner Corridor set, and we're going to call this Death Star set, but again, copyright issues. Now it's a space space cruiser corridor and a space station corridor, and they have proved really, really popular. And again, feel free to check out the link in the video description that I'll put down there in a bit. But yeah, that harkens back to what we were talking about a moment ago, and that again sort of talks about what Hasbro said before about playsets. Do you that's a question I wouldn't mind asking you, Adam, was what's your stance on playsets? Do you think there's a market there for them?
If we had the ability to sell them at Entertainment Earth, I would sell them. We're just not being offered any. I hear from enough people that want them. I don't know how many of you there actually are, but it is an avenue that I will never stop asking Hasbro about whenever I get a chance to talk to them. That's something I want. I want a really nice freeze chamber. Not like the little one we got, but I want something big. I want something I can pay a lot of money for that only 6 or 7 of us are going to want to buy. But I think that's something that is needed, just because if you really want to sell people figures, the figures need somewhere to live, and the figures don't have anywhere to live. Why would I want to buy 100? I bought a lot of Power of the Force 2 Stormtroopers. They're homeless. They need a Death Star. They need a Blockade Runner. They need something to go into. And, you know, the Imperial Troop Transport, fine example. It's a vehicle with 6 figure pockets. You want to have something like that where one hand washes the other. If you buy a vehicle with seats, you need someone to sit in those seats, and you will sell figures to fill that to the average fan. And if you have a collector with thousands of figures, they're going to want to buy vehicles for some of those figures. Maybe not all of them, but a lot of them. So, I would like to see it happen. I think the time to do it may have passed unless they find a new way to do manufacturing. And with manufacturing on demand and the advent of Kickstarter, we saw Matty Collector's Castle Grayskull Gambit worked. I would be interested in seeing what that means for everything else. No one else has really tried it. I'm keeping my eyes open to see what else they can do. I mean, really, any company can do whatever they feel like. It's just Hasbro doesn't feel like doing it. Hasbro's not going to do it.
Yeah, it seems so. That might be a growing thing. The third party low run playsets and other things, but I don't think a third party could get away with figures like they do in Transformers. They would only be able to do environments and playsets and that kind of.
There was one. I didn't get it. I missed the run on it. The Warlord Arian was announced a couple of years ago. It was a Knights of the Old Republic style Neo Crusader. I believe it came out. I did not get one. I'm sorry?
Yeah. I reviewed a couple of those, actually.
Did you like them?
Yeah, that's where I remember seeing them from, was your channel, Steve.
Yeah. Same here.
I kind of did, and I kind of didn't. They didn't feel like Star Wars to me. Obviously, they weren't Star Wars because of all the copyright stuff, but I don't know. I liked them as figures. They were really good, really well made, but they just didn't. Well, it wasn't necessarily the look; it was just the way the figure was made. It doesn't fit in my collection, and it doesn't look like something that would fit in my collection. As I said, it just didn't feel like Star Wars. I thought they were good, by all means, but they just didn't. They were missing something, I think, and I couldn't quite put my finger on what it was. But as I said a minute ago, they're perfectly fine figures, just not what I would have been looking for if that figure had been made legitimately.
Yeah, and there's something you said about branding too, because I don't know what your guys' vice is, but for me, I collect Hasbro Star Wars. If it says Hasbro and Star Wars on the box, I am going to pay lots more attention to it, except for Transformers, because I didn't think those turned out that well. But when it comes to 3 2/4 inch, I am their bitch. I want to support them, and I want to get what they make that is good. If a third-party person made a really good Wampa Cave, my money is theirs. On the other hand, like the Warlord Arian, they were supposed to email me when that thing came out. So I completely missed it, and I don't feel like I missed anything a year out now. Because it's not a Hasbro item, I don't feel like there's a gap in my collection.
Yeah, I agree.
There's even a vintage restyle figure, like I believe there's like a Chewie with like a fuzz to him. That I guess they just took the old molds and added some fuzz. I forget what site that was at. Maybe I'm not thinking.
I would love to see that. Yeah.
I think it was out of the UK. I think UK Toy Collector 77, I think that was the site. Like, I'll send you the link, Adam, if you're interested.
Please, yeah.
So, anybody else have anything else, or I think we were pretty good?
Yeah, I think just about covered.
Let me ask you guys something, if I can throw a question at you. Did you talk about the reaction figures on the show yet? The Super 7 Funko Alien guys?
I kind of spoke about them, but I've seen them. Don't know about you guys.
Have you seen the license list that's going beyond Alien? They're going to do Back to the Future, Goonies, Terminators 1 and 2, Buffy, Firefly. Between my wife and me, we're probably going to buy everything they put out, just because my fear is, fear/hope, this is the line that the older Star Wars collectors may have been waiting for, because we've been buying Star Wars figures because we like old Star Wars figures, but now here are new figures that are like our Star Wars figures. They're not Star Wars, but I don't want to speak for everybody, tell me if I'm wrong, who here doesn't love Back to the Future? I mean, oh my god, I couldn't believe
it's
like,
okay,
Doc and Marty, Kenner style. I'm thrilled. I
mean, yeah,
it's okay, and you're good. But yeah, like if they did Gremlins, Gremlins 2 especially, I would love it. I can't wait. I mean, for me, I see this as being a possible, real, genuine, seismic shift. It could be something like the older fans are with Mego. I missed Mego. Mego was the year before me. Mego was dead by the time I came into being aware of things. But I am a Kenner fan, and Kenner is kind of why I'm here. And Hasbro's kind of making a Kennery product now with their Saga Legends, but a Funko's going to make something that's even more Kennery, and you can't get any more Kennery than those Alien figures. That's an avenue where I'm very curious to see where the future is going to go. Hasbro will probably never do it just because of the It's a specialty item. It's for a certain kind of person. There's not a lot of us. Mm. But I am stupendously eager to see where this shakes out. I want my Sarah Connor figure. I want my Ripley figure like this. I'm going to get my Ripley figure like this in like a month. It's great.
Isn't there like a problem with that, though, with Ripley because of her likeness? With those kind of figures, it's
she looks terrible. She looks nothing like Sigourney Weaver. That's how you get her. No, the original figure looks nothing like her. And likeness is an interesting thing. I've had discussions with a lot of people and how their legal departments get by with this stuff. And I guess in some cases, you can license a character but not an actor. And it gets weird because, like, you'll notice there's never been a Madonna figure or doll, but there are Desperately Seeking Susan mini-mates. Mm-hmm. So there are interesting variations on things
and,
you can do.
In Breathless Mahoney or...
That's true.
From Dick Tracy.
That's true. Since
you know a little bit more about those licenses, are those, like, does it sound like those are all coming out with, like, in the next year, or is that, like, a long-term plan, or no idea?
Well, the thing is, they mentioned them on their on the Funko board. Brian at Funko put a list of things they were looking into / had, and I nag a lot, and it's one of those things where if I knew something, I couldn't tell you, but I can tell you I really don't know what the ETA is, and I certainly haven't seen anything yet. I'm begging to let... I want to give any help I can. I want to... we're close with Funko, and I like Funko. They do great stuff. They have the best licenses, and I really want to see them succeed with this. I just would... I am dying to know what they're going to look like, because how do you fake that look? Zika Toys did it with $6 Million Man admirably, I think. The Steve Austin and the Bigfoot look like old figures they just found, minus the knee joints.
A Kenner one.
Yeah, I mean, they're great. Biff Bang Pow, we do... over there, they got the Mego-style $6 Million Man, and those turned out great, but I like Skinner, and Zika really did a nice job, and there are people out there who are going to understand it, and arguing that aesthetic and getting it down right. I am interested in seeing how much juice that siphons away from Hasbro Star Wars. Mm-hmm. It's just one more little, you know, chip in the dam. I mean, we've seen a decline in the interest of Star Wars, which may be undone by the new movie and new TV show. But on the other hand, we're also in an era where the young people like their apps and their video games a lot more than they like their action figures. And Lego is now the number two toy maker in the world. They beat out Hasbro, which is amazing and scary. Because if you're a Lego guy, that's great. Because Lego, today's generation is probably going to look at Lego the way the older generation looked at the vintage carded Kenner stuff. There's not a lot of it surviving. Box stuff is going to be extremely scarce. It's going to be really expensive. And it was played with, destroyed, lost, and that's important. Mm-hmm. And it's a different mindset. Hasbro is for slightly older people, nothing wrong with that. But, you know, it makes you wonder if the action figure is going the way of the trading card in the comic book. It's going to be more of a prestige product, not something you pay a quarter for and put in the spokes of your bike, or something you read and throw away, but it is only preserved. It is never damaged. It is never enjoyed. Mm-hmm. And what does that mean for our future of the hobby? Yeah, if you don't play with it, it ceases to be a toy. It's like with the Urban Vinyl figures. Some people say they're toys. I disagree. If you can't give it to a child to enjoy, minus price point, of course, it's no longer a toy. And I want toys.
That makes perfect sense. You can already see that with Lego, because a lot of the old sets, if you look at a comparable Lego set, the original retail and what you can get it for now versus the Hasbro item from the same year, the Lego item is always going to be crazy price versus the Hasbro item. Well, thank you, Adam, for coming on this. We're going to go off the air now, and appreciate you taking your time to be on here.
No, anytime. Happy to monopolize the conversation.
Yeah, thanks, Adam.
Yeah, it's been definitely very interesting. Great hearing your thoughts on just the toy industry in general, Adam.
It's a great industry. I highly recommend getting involved if the opportunity comes up.
Yeah. Pretty interesting. What's your favorite Star Wars figure or character? If you've got
As far as figures go, I've realized lately that what appeals to me the most are some of the off-model stuff. The collect all 21 era figures, like Walrusman, Snaggletooth, Greedo. The fact that they're wrong is more interesting than anything authentic you can do, because if you compare them to like Fisher-Price Adventure people or other figures of the day, they mimic an aesthetic It is not inherently Lucasfilm's futuristic used universe. Their wrongness makes them appealing and charming. And I squealed like a little girl when I saw Walrus Man and the Blue Snaggletooth show up on Clone Wars. I mean, that was just the happiest day of my life. Like, I can't believe it! I like that stuff a lot. I just got a jumbo 12-inch Channel Giant Walrus Man. Oh, I love it. It is so great. And as a kid, those were figures I had to track down at garage sales because they were hard to get by 82, 83. And, you know, you had to find someone that had one to sell you. Character? I've always been a big fan of Luke because no one has been jerked around more in a movie saga and comes out kind of feeling okay. I mean, what a horrible life this kid has. Like, what happened? Well, you get taken away from your parents. Then your aunt and uncle get killed. Then you finally meet a girl. Oh, great, there's this chick. And she likes
out
you.
Your sister.
Oh, she's my sister. Okay, well, let's go to this school for a while. Oh, your best friend is being frozen and cryogenic, and that's great. Oh, and your dad cuts off your hand after you find out your dad's not dead. Your father abandoned you for 20 years, and now he's going to kick your ass. And then when it's all said and done, you have to kill your dad and his boss. And when you're all left and done, you've destroyed the government. You've completely destabilized the world as you know it. People are probably not very happy with you. I'm sure there's some people that are very upset that whatever lucrative contract they have is now over. And now it's your fault. And guess what? You have to put it all back together again. After someone committed genocide of an entire race, it's on you. Congratulations, Luke. Your life sucks now. Good on you for doing the right thing. The rest, from here on out, your life is miserable. I can relate. No good deed goes unpunished.
Great, all that stuff. Yep.
I think that's a good place to end.
I don't think I've ever heard an analysis quite like that. That was brilliant.
Well, that's fast.
That was great. Yeah. We're going off, guys. Thanks for watching, and until next time. You want to go with your trademark signature video ending, Steve?
Keep collecting, and may the force be with you.